Well, Happy New Year's. Happy 2017. Why don't you grab a Bible? You find a Bible on the seat in front of you. If you're down here on the floor, or underneath your seat, if you're up in our stadium seating, and turn with me to Mark 6. Pardon me, as we pick back up in the Gospel of Mark. Mark 6, we'll be starting in verse 14. It'll be on page 841. 841. The Gospel of Mark was written by a guy named John Mark, and he wrote this off of Peter, who was one of Jesus' closest friends and who was an eyewitness to the life of Jesus. And he wrote this based on Peter's notes. And he was also engaged in some of this as well. And we'll get to some of that as we move further into the book. Mark 6, starting verse 14 on page 841. A missionary moved with his family to a South Sea island, to a group of people that had not had the chance to hear about who Jesus is, to either say yes or no to him. And he went and he spent time learning the language and learning the cultures and engaged with them, lived among them, loved them well. He was humble. He was forgiving. He lived in a very loving way with these folks. But then he caught a very rare disease and he died. About a year later, another missionary went, knowing that a missionary had already been there. He begins to gather up these folks and in the evening around the fire begins to tell them stories like we've been looking at out of the Gospel of Mark about the life of Jesus. And after he'd shared several of these stories over several nights, one of the people finally said, "This guy you're talking about, he lived here. He was here. He was just here a couple years ago, but he died. He lived among us." And the missionary said, no, you don't understand. This man lived 2,000 years ago. And then they all started piping, no, we saw him. This person that you're describing, this person whose stories you're telling us, we lived with him. Let me ask you this question. If someone was told the story of Jesus, would they think about you? Would they go, "Oh, I've met Jesus," and they would use your name? If someone heard the story of Jesus, would they be convinced that it was you, that it was me? Because our stories are so much alike. There are some of you here this morning that have come on an arm of a friend. You've come to kick the tires, to try this thing out, to see what this is all about. And you're here because of the credibility of this person who brought you, this family member, this coworker, this friend. The power of a transformed life. Let's pray and let's jump into the story. Father, we invite you into this space. Of course, you're here. You're everywhere all the time. But that invitation is for us. We are mindful that we need to hear from you. We invite you, Father, to whisper in our ear and nudge us in our heart as you are so faithful to do. Father, I thank you that your word never returns to you void, it says in Isaiah, that when your word goes out, it accomplishes your agenda in the hearts of people. And we trust that again in this moment. So with that in mind, I would pray graciously, whatever I would say that is not of you would quickly be forgotten. But it's when I say your words after you, that's when there's hope and conviction and encouragement. Fill us with your spirit, Father, for your spirit is our teacher, our convictor, the one who makes much of Jesus. And as James says, Father, James writes, may we not just be merely hearers of your word, but may we be doers of your word, living differently because we've engaged with you. Now with our heads bowed, let me give you a moment to pray. And maybe your prayer simply is this morning. Father God, speak to me. I'm listening. In Jesus' name, amen. Mark 6, verse 14, starting on page 841. The Bible, most of us think, is kind of written like a G movie. Maybe every now and then you come across a PG-13 piece. Well, let me tell you something. The story today is rated R. It's rated R. It's like Jerry Springer's show. Now, let me share this story with you. The story's about a guy named Herod Antipas. And let me just give you some background. Let me show you this first slide up here to see if we can get it all straight. Herod the Great was the king of the Jews, the king of Israel during the birth of Jesus, and then he died. He had four sons. All four of his sons are named Herod, just like George Foreman's, all his boys are named George. And so you got Herod Antipas, and then Herod Philip are the two characters we're going to talk about in just a moment. And then you have this woman named Herodias, who is the daughter of one of the brothers, who ends up marrying Philip. You see where I'm going? All right, so that's kind of the background of this. Let me show you a picture of Herod Antipas. This was a bust of him from that day, ruled from 4 BC to 39 AD. Let's go to the next one. He was what's called a tetrarch. A tetrarch was the land that his father ruled was divided up amongst these four brothers. And so he had what was in green. Tiberias would have been the capital for his area. And then Perea, which you see down here at the right, which is divided, has this place called Machias. And Machias is where this story takes place that we're going to talk about in just a moment. Machias was a palace, and it was one of several palaces that Herod had. His headquarters was up in Tiberias, but he would come down to here because it was near the Dead Sea. Let's go to that next picture. On the left-hand side is what it looks like today. This is what that palace looks like today. And on the right-hand side, based on archaeological finds, is what the artists believe that it would have looked like in the time of Jesus. I've been there and walked up. It's a pretty steep area, in a very big area. But it's close to the Dead Sea, and it's where you would have gone for R&R. Now, here's what's going on. Jesus comes into this area. Jesus comes into this area, and he's doing what Jesus does and all the things we love about Jesus. He's engaging with the poor and the needy. He is healing people, he and his disciples. And word gets back to Herod Antipas. Word gets back to him in Tiberias. But he is shocked. He is surprised. He's not quite sure who this guy is. And he asks his advisors, and his advisors say, maybe this is the prophet of old. Maybe it's one of the Old Testament prophets. And some of them say, maybe it's Elijah, who is a very well-known prophet, probably the best-known prophet in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures. And then some say to him, it's John the Baptist that has come back from the grave. And that's who Herod thought he was. Now, that's what's going on, but here's the backstory. Herod Antipas goes to visit his brother Philip in Rome. Philip had married his niece, Herodias. Herod Antipas falls in love with Herodias and says to her, leave your husband, oh, by the way, my brother, leave your husband and come, move in with me. I'll marry you. And she said, okay, if you divorce your wife. And so they get married and they move to Tiberias. John the Baptist, who is a prophet, gets wind of this. He hears of this. And because of Leviticus and what it says in Leviticus, he goes and he addresses Herod. He confronts Herod and tells him, what you've done is unlawful. What you've done is wrong. Well, Herod throws John in jail. But here's what's interesting. Herod really liked John, even though John kept telling him the truth. Skip down with me and look with me at verse 20. For Herod feared John the Baptist, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he kept him safe. And when he heard him, he was greatly perplexed or troubled within his soul, and yet he heard him gladly. So from time to time, he brings John out of the prison, and John comes, and John speaks truth to him, and John challenges him. And Herod likes to listen, and he knows there's something about what John says that is true. But what about Herodias? Look back with me at verse 19. And Herodias had a grudge against John and wanted to put him to death, but she could not. She hated John because John was a conscience to Herod Antipas. She wanted John out of the picture. She wanted to scheme a way to get rid of John. And it seems to appear from the story that she has found her way. Look at verse 21. But an opportunity came for Herodias. When Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his nobles and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. He gathered these people together for a banquet, 5 miles from the Dead Sea, great place to relax, get away from all the struggles and difficulties of life, and he throws himself a birthday party. Now, Jews didn't celebrate birthdays. Only Greeks and Romans celebrated birthdays in those days. So it tells you how deeply ingrained in the culture, away from what it means to be a follower of God, that Herod has become. Well, he throws this party. Now, what they have found in that palace that I showed you, they found two dining rooms, two fancy dining rooms that have what's called a triclinium table, which is a U-shaped table for banquets. One was larger and one was a little bit smaller. The smaller one would have been for the women. The women would have gotten together and had their own banquet while the men get together. While the men are together, Herod calls for his daughter. Probably Herodias pushes her daughter into this. This is not Herod's daughter, it's his stepdaughter. She's probably about 13 years old. You can imagine that her mother has taught her how to dance in such a way that would be appealing to men. Remember, that's men, and I'll let you kind of picture what kind of dancing's taking place in the stag party. And so this young woman comes out, and she dances in such a way that so pleases Herod that Herod says to her, I will give you anything you want up to half my kingdom. You name it. Now, it seems like this is exactly what Herodias was looking for. And the daughter comes back to her mom, and she goes, Mom, I don't know what I asked for. Do I ask for a chariot, a new toga? What do I ask for? The mother had been waiting for this moment. She was looking for an opportunity to obligate her husband to not change his mind. So she says, you go back in front of all those officials, and you ask for John the Baptist's head. So the young woman goes back into the midst of this party and stands before her stepfather and says, I demand John the Baptist's head on a silver platter brought to me. Now Herod, if Herod had any kind of character, Herod would have said to her, I will not commit murder for you. But because he has no character, part of the reason why he's so fascinated with John, because John was someone who had great character. He sends to another part of the palace where the prison was, and he has John beheaded. Very unlike this. Typically, Jewish people were crucified because they weren't Roman citizens. Only Roman citizens were beheaded. But because this had to happen so quickly, he beheads him and brings the head back to her on a silver platter. Now, there's several things about this story that I find fascinating, this true, tragic story. One of them is John's courage to speak into power and to confront power. But the other big one that I want us to look at is the fact that when Jesus shows up after John is beheaded, that Jesus acts and speaks so much like John that Jesus is mistaken for John. The power of a transformed life. The power of a transformed life, as we think about what this means. We've been talking about all fall, about what it means to have that one person in your life that you know and you love and you care about, who is a friend, maybe a family member, a coworker, but someone you would rearrange your life to be with, and they would rearrange their life to be with you, that you enjoy their company and you share life together. And this person is far from God. They're not a project for you. They are a person created in the image of God, someone that you care about. And as you talk about the important things in your life and they share their important things, you share of yours, and you talk about your spiritual story with them because it's so significant for you. You are a picture of who Jesus is to that person. You are a picture of who Jesus is to that person. If Jesus showed up today and Jesus was to go to where you work and people got a chance to spend time with Jesus, would your coworkers say, he acts and speaks so much like you? If Jesus went to your house and lived with your family, would your family go, he's funnier than you, but he acts just like you, Dad. He acts just like you, Mom. If Jesus lived in your house with your roommates, would your roommates mistake Jesus for you because the two of you act so much alike? We are living in a post-Christian world. We're living in a post-Christian culture, even here in Chicago. More and more people have no point of reference of who Jesus is. Last year, a survey was taken by the Barna Institute, and over 50% of millennials don't believe that Jesus was God. Two-thirds of Americans believe that Jesus sinned, that he did some things wrong, which would then disqualify him in being God. More and more, I am running into people that have no point of reference. Many times, I've stood down here where people have come up and introduced themselves after service, and they'll go, this is my first time. And I say to them, glad you're here. And then as we get into the conversation, I find out it's their first time ever to a church. And we are glad you're here. This is exactly why we're here, is to help people like you, because all of us at one time was just like that. understand who Jesus is. And folks, our apologetic, which means an explanation of the faith, our apologetic is living in such a way that when people see us, they would understand Jesus. It is a powerful apologetic for you and I to live credible lives in such a way that when people see us, they would know Jesus. We aren't perfect, but are we credible? The power of a transformed life. Owning our mistakes. I am sorry. Will you forgive me? How we handle difficulties, our failures, worry, fear. How we handle successes. Are we quick to share success? How we date. The pursuit of purity and respect. How we love our spouse and how we love our children. How we do our job. Are we credible at our jobs? What kind of friend are we? What kind of roommate are we? Are we trustworthy? Are we compassionate? Do we care about the poor and the needy and the broken and the homeless and the widow? People are watching us. They're observing us. They are looking to what we're really like because we carry a label as a Christ follower, but do they see Christ in us? You can see such a contrast in the story between Herod, Antipas, and John the Baptist. John, who had great character. John, who lived a very credible life. And Herod, who had no character. Do people see the contrast of who we are? The credibility of our life? Do they see the power of how the gospel has changed us? I was reading a story recently about an anthropologist who visited a tribe that were cannibals. He got permission from the chief, and he went in, and he observed them. He was going to write a paper. And one day as he was walking at dusk, he was walking past a man who was sitting at a campfire with a large pot of water boiling, and he walked by seeing this man reading. And it fascinated him that someone in the tribe, one, could read, and second, would have a book. So he walked over to the man, and he said, "What are you reading?" And the man from the tribe said, "Well, I'm reading the Bible." And the anthropologist kind of looked at him and smirked and said, "You need to know that civilized, educated people don't believe in the Bible. They believe it's a fable and that there's no God and no power in this God." And then the gentleman from the tribe stepped back and he looked at the anthropologist from top to bottom and he said, "Let me tell you something. Without the power that is in this book, you'd be in that pot right now being prepared for dinner." The power of the gospel to change life, a transformed life. Now, I think that all of us would say, as followers of Jesus, that we need to change. And I think to a level, all of us are committed to change. I don't think any of us here are going, "I like my life just like it is. I don't need to change anything." I think most of us would say, yeah, we're committed to change. In fact, we're a culture that's committed to change. The self-help industry is a $10 billion industry a year. Books, podcasts, seminars, to make ourselves better. We want to be better. We realize there's things to change. 41% of us, I read just this week, at December 31st, made New Year's resolutions to change something, to be committed to something. I belong to Export, and I know that the first 3 weeks of January, when I go to work out, place is going to be packed. But if I just wait 3 weeks, it'll get back to normal. We are committed to some level of change. But many times, what we're committed to is slapping on a clean coat of paint on our lives, tweaking some behaviors, tweaking some things. "I've gained too much weight, and I need to lose weight. I need to eat better. I need to be healthier. I need to stop smoking. I need to drink less. I need to work less. I need to read more. I'm only going to date emotionally healthy men. Well, I'm going to stop dating emotionally needy women. I'm going to spend less. I'm going to save more. I'm going to invest better." We have all these things that we want to tweak in our life, but frankly, how long do these changes really last? We may end up looking better, but we never experienced deep change. Philip Pullman, an English author, the author of The Golden Compass, says this: you can't change what you are, only what you do. You can't change what you are, only what you do. And as a follower of Christ, we'd say, no, we don't believe that's true. We don't believe that we cannot deeply change. And not just change into a nice Midwest sensibility, just to be good, morally good, kind people. Yeah, because I think most of us in here would go, we're good people. The answer is not a better version of me, a better version of you. The answer for us as followers of Christ is a new me. It's a new you, to be transformed in the character and likeness of Christ. And see, this gospel that we've been talking about through the gospel of Mark, gospel which literally means great news, great news. Here's the great news. We slap paint over ourselves, but what we slap paint over is really rotting from the inside out. Great news. But we're reminded that God has not given up on us. That the great news is that God is committed to bring about significant deep change in us. The gospel, this work of grace, is able to do something in us that we could not do for ourselves. We can slap paint on, we can change our behaviors, but we're still selfish. We're still jealous. We're still bitter. We still have trouble forgiving. We're still lazy. We are still looking out for us first. We still lie in order to protect our fannies. But this gospel of grace comes in and begins to do a deep spiritual work in us from the inside out. Let me remind you what it says in 2 Corinthians 5:17. We'll put it up here. Paul, a guy named Paul, wrote a letter to a church in Corinth, which is just outside of Athens, Greece. He says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. We're not partially new. It's not just new behaviors. It's not a new coat of paint. As a follower of Christ, we are a new creation. Not a better me, but a better Jesus. I get this new life by trusting in Christ. When I believe him for who he says he is, and I understand why I have a need for him, that I've rebelled against him, and that he himself has rescued me from my rebellion, that he has paid his life, then I begin to understand there is hope. In fact, if you just drop a couple of verses down to 2 Corinthians 5:21, one of my favorite verses in the Bible, it says, for our sake, God made Jesus to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in Christ we might become the righteousness of God. This great exchange takes place for us, that all of our rebellion, all of our resistance, all of our ugliness, all of those things that are true within us, even when we look better on the outside, all those things placed on Jesus as he hangs on a cross. Covered, forgiven, paid for. But the second half of this is also our hope. In his righteousness, his perfection, his power is now poured into us. We are a new creation because Jesus is investing himself in us. The very essence of the gospel is that when Jesus died on the cross, he took my old, broken, rebellious, self-improving, but failing life with him in his death. And then in his resurrection, that in his resurrection from the dead, his new life, Jesus gave me a new life, a new creation that is able to deeply change me from what I once was. The righteousness of God is at work in us. It is actively engaged in us. And because of our relationship with Jesus, we become more loving. We become more compassionate. We become more of a servant. We become more patient, more generous. We begin to think about others before we begin to think about ourselves. You know what? We become the person that we want others to be for us. We become the person that we want others to become for us. When we think about a spouse, when we think about a friend, when we think about a roommate, we think about what we want this person to be for us, how to love us, how to treat us. We become that person because of the work of the Spirit of God in our life. This kind of life creates curiosity. John the Baptist lived this kind of life, and Herod was curious. He wanted to speak to him, troubled by him, but wanted to hear him because he could not explain this kind of life. The world sees this kind of life, and it troubles them because it makes no sense, this inward-outward change. I was sitting with a young man who came in, who was introduced by one of you, a mutual friend. And he came in, he was very troubled and struggling, very difficult season in his life, and he tells me his story, and I look at him and go, how can I help you? You know what he answered? Here's his answer to me. I want what Josh has, this mutual friend. I want what Josh has. Because Josh, he's gone through similar things that I'm going through. He handled them very differently than I'm handling. What does Josh have? Can you explain that to me? How you choose to live your life creates a curiosity for those who observe, who watch. Now, if I may, just have a pastoral moment for a second. Some of you are sitting here and you feel this great guilt and shame because you've looked at your life over the last several weeks, the last several months, and you see no credibility, no spiritual credibility because maybe of some decisions that you've made and the way in which you've lived toward others. And so you wonder, how could I ever live this way? But remember, the hope of the gospel is that when we come to God and we admit to those things that God already knows to be true, He's been waiting for us to come and to share these things that we understand. That the work of this great news is grace moves toward us. Forgiveness moves toward us again and again and again. And what happens is when we experience God's grace that we now have a power to begin to go and to fix the things that we have broken through some of these decisions that we've made, these broken relationships that we've created. And now we go back and we look people in the eye and we say, will you forgive me? Will you forgive me for what I've done? Will you forgive me for the hurt that I've caused? Will you forgive me? And now those people have a front row seat to watch spiritual transformation take place. Now, will they be skeptical and cynical? Absolutely, some will. But as you live this out day after day and week after week and month after month, and they see that this is an authentic change, it creates a curiosity in them and said, what happened here? What happened here? The gospel provides several tools for us, several tools in this spiritual transformation. There is a sculptor that is looking at our lives and sculpting our lives around a model. And the model is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is held out there for us as the one in which our life is to look like, to be transformed into his character, to be transformed into his behavior. We think and we begin to act differently. Every sculptor has a model in mind. I love sculpture. And so when you look at some piece of sculpture like David, Michelangelo, there was some model that he had in mind. I mean, look at that body. I think he was thinking of me right there. We know that Michelangelo was someone that studied the human body, and so he had these pictures in mind when he chiseled this out, this beautiful piece of sculpture. A couple years ago, my family, we went to the Black Hills of South Dakota, and we saw Mount Rushmore, very impressive. Then we got in the car and we traveled a bit and we saw a monument they're working on, Crazy Horse's monument that was started in 1948. Crazy Horse was a Sioux Indian. And he's sitting on his horse and he's pointing out and he's being asked, where are your lands now? And Crazy Horse is responding, my lands are where the dead lie buried. Now, Mount Rushmore was impressive, but I'm telling you what, this was incredible. Just the face, Mount Rushmore was 60 feet. The faces are 60 feet. This one is 87 feet. The whole monument is three times the length of Niagara Falls. This whole monument is bigger than the Giza Pyramid. I mean, this thing is massive. But someone didn't just go up there and begin to chisel away. There was a model, and you see the model in the foreground. There is a picture in mind. And so what God does is he holds his son up and he says, this is what I want your life to look like. This is a credible life. When your life begins to look like his, that's a spiritually transformed life. Our problem is that we shoot too low. We accept too little. We expect so less of ourselves. But the model that God gives us in Jesus raises our view and our hope that it is possible to change from the inside out, being transformed in the character and likeness of Jesus. There's a model, but there's a sculptor, and the sculptor is the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. The Spirit of God is the one who's chiseling our lives, who is breaking away those tough and resistant areas that we might begin to look more like Jesus, to be transformed in the likeness of Jesus. And you know what he primarily uses? He primarily uses God's word, God's love letter to us, the Bible. The last several years, there's been a lot of research around spiritual transformation in Christendom, a lot of research. And you know what they're consistently finding? Every study is consistently finding. It's not going to church that changes you. It's not being part of a small group that changes you. It's not giving or serving that changes you. The number one, by far and away, no close second, is the time that you and I engage in God's word. Those who engage in God's word experience greater spiritual transformation than those who don't. The Spirit of God takes God's word and applies it and chisels away at our life so we begin to change. When you and I come and sit under the teaching, when you and I read on a daily basis, when you and I are engaged in a small group, we discuss the word, these are all things that God uses to come to bear, that the Holy Spirit, as the sculpture, takes to begin to transform our life. He uses our difficulties, our failures, our fears and our worries, our joys and our successes. As the word of God is applied in these circumstances, we begin to think and respond differently in a chiseled way. And as the pieces fly, the image becomes clearer and clearer. We look more and more like Jesus. The Spirit of God uses the voice of others in our life, those people who love us and care for us, who will speak the truth to us, those people who know us and have not read our press clippings, that are not all that impressed with us, but who will say to us true things that we need to hear. The Spirit of God takes God's word and he applies it to our life. And the third tool, it's not only a model, not only a sculptor, but the same Spirit who is the sculptor is also the same power that resides in the life of every follower of Jesus. When we become a new creation, God comes and resides in us. He takes up residence in us. Not only does he convict us and encourage us, but he empowers us toward change. He moves us toward change. When we repent, when we recognize that we have failed and we have hurt and offended God and others, when we turn, there is a power that rushes in us to move us along, to do what is difficult to do. The power of a transformed life. In a world where people have such a poor picture of Jesus, may it be said of us that when someone reads them and tells them about the life of Jesus, may they say, I've already met him. I've already met him. And may it be us. Beheading has been around for a long time. John the Baptist was beheaded 2,000 years ago, and then last February 2015, we watched on TV when 21 men were brought out by ISIS to be beheaded. Do you remember this picture? Just recently, I got a little more of the backstory. Someone who watched the whole video who understands Arabic. 20 of the 21 men were Egyptians. The one you see there circled was from Ghana. 20 of the 21 men, the Egyptians, were strong, authentic followers of Jesus. The man from Ghana was not a follower of Christ, but got caught up in this crew. But as the days were being prepared for their death, he had a front row seat to watch these 20 men respond. how they spoke to each other and reminded each other the hope that they have in their eternity. And he had a chance to see this and observe this and watch this. And then these 21 men were marched out to the shores of Libya and forced to kneel. And then one by one, they go down the row and they say, "Will you denounce Christ and profess Islam?" And the 20 Egyptians all say over and over again, you can read it on their lips, "The Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ." When they came in, the man in the middle, the man from Ghana, he had a chance to watch and observe and to see and to notice. And they asked him the same questions. "Will you denounce Christ? Will you profess Islam?" And his response, "Their God is my God. Their God is my God." And in that time that he had to watch and observe and to see their courage, to watch them live out Jesus, he was able to say, "Their God is my God. I have seen Jesus for the first time, and he looks like these 20 men." Let's bow our head. There are a couple times a year in our culture when we pause and kind of think about the next season. For some of us, it's the fall and the beginning of a school year. We kind of stop and just say, what do we need to think through and what changes do we need to make? January obviously is one for many of us. For some, it's the beginning of summer. But we pause in this natural time and we ask, God, what is it you want to get after in my life? How can I look more like you? For many of us in this room, it would just be picking up his word and beginning to engage in it on a regular basis. And we would begin to experience spiritual transformation. For some of us, it's like Lisa shared, getting in a small group to talk about it with others and to be challenged and encouraged and be able to encourage and challenge others around God's word. May we be a faith community that when people hear the story of Jesus, they think of us. Father God, I pray for us. May we not just be settled with changing behaviors, but may we be committed to a much deeper change that only comes about through the work of your Spirit. We are a new creation. May we believe that. May we trust that. And may we trust that you are taking your Spirit, the sculptor, and your Son, the model, and you are bringing about significant change in us so that we might be Jesus in our world. We thank you in Jesus' name.